Annie, bonjour. I'm Robin Wall Kimmerer, author of Braiding Sweetgrass, and I am delighted to be with you to introduce my friend and colleague, Monique Gray Smith, who created the adaptation of Braiding Sweetgrass for young adults. I am so grateful for the grace, the skill, and the insights with which she brought these teachings to a younger audience in ways which educate and mostly inspire a deeper relationship with land and with Indigenous culture. Monique is of Cree, Lakota, and Scottish ancestry and lives today in the Greenlands near Victoria, BC. She's also the loving mother of two young adults, and she brings all of those perspectives to her work as a writer. Her first novel, Tilly, A Story of Hope and Resilience, won the 2014 BERT Award for First Nations, Métis, and Inuit Literature, which was followed by Tilly and the Crazy Eights, which I've just finished reading and I'm just still glowing from. She is also the author of several books for children, including You Hold Me Up. My heart fills with happiness when we are kind and speaking our truth, a journey of reconciliation. In all of those titles, you hear her particular gifts for love, for kindness, for truth, and for joy. She is a writer of relationships and of healing. It has been a joy and an honor to work with Monique, and I'm eager for you to hear from her.
Thank you. Yeah, Kinanaskomotin, Michael, and geez, how do I follow that with Robin? My goodness. Tansaintotimak, Mitaninanaskomon, Kinanaskomotin to the Lekwungen speaking peoples whose territory I'm gifted to be joining you from today. And when I look out my windows, I see so much green, and I see the long decades and decades and decades and decades of those who care took and stewarded this beautiful land that we now know as Victoria, British Columbia. And the storms are just about to come in, so we will be getting rain for the first time in months, and we really need some rain. The earth needs to be healed from the water that needs to come, and our creeks, where the salmon are hopefully going to be able to come home to spawn, need the water for us to be able to welcome them home. I am the granddaughter of Noel Cardinal. He was born in File Hills, Treaty 4 in Saskatchewan. My grandmother was Isabel Gray. And on my dad's side, I'm the granddaughter of Raymond Smith and Beatrice Johnstone. And as Robin said, I have twins who are going to be 20 in like a few days. And I don't know how that happened. Well, I know how that happened, but I don't know how it's going to be. They're going to be 20. Like it feels like a blink of an eye, although there have been some very long days. And I'm absolutely thrilled to be with you today to go on a journey to talk about, our love for the land, our love for the water, our love for the stars, our love for all living beings. And I was grateful. I saw when Glenn first joined us before we had actually begun with all of you, I saw the logs behind him and I wondered if he was at a sweat lodge or if he was chopping wood and getting prepared for the winter. I was like, I love that he's outside and joining us in that way. So I'm grateful to him for the beautiful medicine he laid down for us for the day, and Michael for your smile and the beautiful way we started today. So I already feel warm and like I'm part of the circle. And I think that's, one of the teachings that's important in our ways. And it is something that's in Braiding Sweetgrass and Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults is this society that we live in now really values belongings. And one of the things that I hope that us as humans, when we read books, when we connect with each other, even if it's virtually like this, that we feel a sense of belonging. And for me, I know one of the times that I feel the greatest sense of belonging, like it actually chokes me up a little bit. Like I feel like I, like my cells operate and function differently when I'm outside, especially when I'm outside barefoot, working in the garden, working in my yard, harvesting. This year, I grew way more tobacco than ever before here. You know, before we started this morning, I smudged with sweetgrass that I was able to grow. And it does make me teary because it is an act of reconciliation. It is a healing act to be able to grow our own medicines, to be able to grow our own food. This year, my son moved home. He spent the last 2 years playing college baseball in the States, and he had a shoulder injury, so he's home this year. So my food garden was mostly potatoes because he's a 19-year-old athlete, so we need a lot of potatoes and a lot of rice. We buy those great big bags from Costco. But when we can grow our own foods, like I see him eating these potatoes and like he changes. Because there's something about when we put our hands in the earth, when our toenails get dirty because we're in the earth, when we dig things up, when we add to them, and when we visit about what we're growing. I sit here in Victoria on our Friendship Center board. Our Friendship Centers are a place in urban settings where we offer multiple programs, including language, cultural programming, grade 12, upgrading, job, all kinds of things, early childhood, daycares, Head Start. And at one board meeting, we were visiting, and I was talking about, I had captured this short video of a bee flying into one of the flowers on my tobacco, and just watching them do their work in this flower. And one of my colleagues, her name is Siguan, she said, "You know, when those flowers are just about ready to come off with ease, when you can pull them off with ease," she said, "if you drop them back into the earth, they will actually inspire the plant, whatever it is that they leave in the earth inspires the plant to even grow taller." I was like, oh. And so I see that now. But if we had just gotten right to business, if we had not been visiting, I would have missed that gift. She would have missed the gift of being able to share that wisdom, and I would have been missed the gift of being a recipient. And those of you who are able to grow tobacco, now perhaps that's a new gift for you. So I want to pop in. I've got a bit of a sharing to do today virtually. We'll see just how much. Oh, sorry, just give me one moment here. Oh, my chat thing keeps wanting to come up. There we go. Sorry, let me stop here for a minute and reshare. Oh, for some reason, the Honorable Harvest wants to come up right away. That's so interesting. All right. Can you just let me know that you can see that, Michael? Can you just give me a thumbs up? You can see it. Awesome. Okay, great.
We see the presenter version. So it's not full screen, but we could see you and
the upcoming
slides. Yeah.
Better?
Yep, that's it.
Okay, awesome. Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for your patience. So today I'm going to be sharing about this teaching that love is medicine. And it's woven into all the work that I do, whether it's in the books or sharing or when I'm outside. Because I think when we're planting, when we're harvesting, when we're gathering, when we're visiting with our gardens, when we're visiting with the trees, when we're visiting with all living beings, that when we emit this emotion of love, things grow bigger. And not necessarily just so that we can consume more, but that we are in a reciprocal relationship. And so the love that I express then comes back to me. That is, you know, the love to the land, to the water, to all living beings then comes back to me as gifts. And so for me, I live very close to this beautiful area called Pakals. Forest is about a block from my house. And about 2 years ago, my dad got very sick with cancer, and this forest saved me. I would go in there previously many times, but it became a place where I would go to heal, to recalibrate. The cedar trees, the branches would brush off whatever I no longer needed to carry. That creek that you can see on the right there is called Douglas Creek. I would sit so that my heart would flow downstream. So whatever I had to let go of, the water could carry it out to the ocean. And you know, when we're outside, that first inch and a half of the earth's floor is called humus. And when we smell it in our brain, it releases oxytocin and serotonin, which are the love hormones. They're the hormones that calm our central nervous system. And so, you know, at that time with my dad, there was a lot of trauma unfolding. So in my brain, I had a lot of this chemical called cortisol. So the forest was my medicine. It would lower that stress hormone and increase the love hormone so I could be in the world. And so this is my invitation to you, is today at some point, get outside and just notice the smell, especially first thing in the morning when you open a window or open the door, or come, if you're in an apartment building, come out of the elevator and onto the earth. The smell of outside is like, and notice how the seasons change. Notice how if there's dew, notice how if there's been rain. Notice, you know, we don't get it very often, but we're getting it more due to the climate changes. Notice if there's snow. Snow has a smell. So just paying attention to these cycles allows them to be more in tune with ourselves as well. So I want to give you a moment of, some of you might have had a busy morning already, to just ground and be here. And so this is 60 seconds of sound. So the first 15 seconds are the sailor's sea. The next 15 seconds are the birds in my backyard in the spring. The next 15 seconds are this Douglas Creek that you see here. And then the last 15 seconds are a campfire. So just allow these sounds and this image to bring you to this moment. And just let out an exhale and notice yourself settle in a little bit more. Maybe you've noticed your shoulders have dropped. Maybe you actually can feel the chair or wherever you're sitting below you. Maybe you noticed, you know, your lips came up a bit or your eyes softened. And this is the gift of nature, whether we are in her presence physically and also virtually and auditorily. She is medicine for us, and we need to be medicine for her. So for me, because I'm a guest here on these Lekwungen speaking people's territory, my responsibility is to care for this land that I'm gifted to live upon in the absolute best way possible. And so I wanted to start this way because I think this teaching that we have to unlearn hurrying is really important for us, especially when we're talking about being out on the land and harvesting and caring for and creating our own food and our medicines, that when we rush that process, sometimes we get physically hurt. And so this unlearning of hurrying, we can't say to, you know, the raspberry bush, could you hurry up and produce those raspberries? Because next weekend, I actually have time to freeze them. That doesn't happen. And so we have to unlearn this hurrying. And this is a braid of sweetgrass with a message in it that comes from Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults that Michael spoke about and that Robin Wall Kimmerer spoke about. And throughout the book, there are these braids of sweetgrass with really key sentences in them for reflection. And I'll share a couple more of them as we go along. But you know, I never ever thought that I would be an author. It was not anything I ever was in my imagination. But my dad used to say to me lots of times, he would say, "Now, Monique, did that really happen? Or is that one of your stories?" And it was often a story. I had an incredible imagination, and it helped me to survive childhood in many ways. I'm trained as a psychiatric nurse, and I worked for a year and a half in acute psych in the hometown where I grew up called Kamloops. And about a year and a half after working, I applied to the University of Victoria to their School of Social Work. And part of that application, I had to write a personal statement about why I wanted to be a social worker. And when I came down for my interview, I walked in and there was a long table and there was five women sitting there. I had never been in a panel interview before. It's very intimidating, but it was like a force pushed me into the chair. And I went through my interview. And as I was leaving, I had my hand on the door. And one of those women said, "I look forward to reading your book one day." I really didn't think she was talking to me at that point. I was only 6 months sober and I didn't graduate. Even though I went back and got my grade 12 and went to nursing school, I still had self-limiting beliefs about who I could be in the world. So I kept opening that door. And she said, "Wait, Monique, I'm talking to you. I look forward to reading your book one day." Well, I got out of that room as fast as I could. I ran to my car. I had a little 1974 Toyota Corolla. I sat in there. I was covered in goosebumps. My heart was pounding. Because what she did is, in many of our nations, our old teaching of you speak the future for somebody. And if that future isn't aligned with their gifts, all kinds of energies, occurrences, situations, people, opportunities come into place to help that person fulfill the gift they've been blessed with in order to contribute to the wellness of the world. For over 20 years, I kept getting messages. And you know how we get like that was like the first little ping, like a little rock. And then if we don't pay attention, we get, you know, bigger rocks, and then we get boulders and we get bricks. And for over 20 years, I didn't listen. And then I had a near-death experience. And it was like the whole brick wall came down. And I knew that I had to listen to those messages. And all those 20 some years, I kept asking myself, who am I to write a book? And after that near-death experience, I start to ask, what would I write about? And the questions we ask ourselves are so important because our brain and our spirit will search for the answers. So sometimes when I'm out on the land and I'm thinking, what do I need to know in harvesting this medicine? Because there are some medicines that I didn't grow up learning how to harvest. And sometimes we don't have an auntie or an uncle to help us. And so we have to be very quiet for a moment and ask the medicine, "Help me to know how to harvest you." That's the quietness. That's the questions. And for me, sometimes if an answer doesn't come, it's like, okay, I'm not supposed to harvest you. I'm supposed to leave. And so that woman for me back there at UVic was a cookie person. That's what I call these people that come into our life who see something in us that we don't yet see in ourselves and invite us to be bigger than we think we can be. And I don't mean by ego. I don't mean in that Western way, but invite us to use the gifts we've been blessed with to contribute. And so throughout today, my invitation to you is to think about some of the cookie people in your life. Perhaps they're aunties or uncles or grandparents, maybe even a stranger who's come along to help you on your journey around understanding roots, understanding medicine, understanding your own heart, understanding your garden or your window lettuces or your window tomatoes, however you're growing. Whether that is a tangible food or medicine, or you're growing your heart in this time, so that when it's time to grow another being. You were there in a good space. So I think about our cookie people, and I invite you to reach out to those people, you know, to call them, to visit them, to FaceTime them. You can send an email, you can send a card. Please don't text them. Like, really take some time to offer your gratitude for their gifts that they brought to you in their life, in your life. And so for me, you know, as Dr. Robin Wall Kimmerer talked about, the first book was Tilly. And after that, I thought, okay, I'm all done. I listened to the messages. And then one day I was working at an Aboriginal Head Start, our cultural preschools. And I was doing some work with the families and the grandparents and the aunties and the uncles and the staff. And at lunchtime, the children joined us. 33, 4, 5-year-olds came in, and you can imagine that everything changed. But there was one little guy whose temperament was a little more cautious. And he stood by the door. And then when he saw his cookum, his grandma in my language, he ran right over to her. And she took his face in her hands like this. And she looked at him with so much love. His whole body changed. And what I saw was his heart filled with happiness. And it got me thinking, like, what fills my heart with happiness? I thought about it on my ferry ride home and off and on for a couple weeks. And then one day I was in a meeting and the whole book came, illustrated by the incredible Julie Flett. And so for me, one of the times that my heart really is full is being outside on the land or by the water or under the stars, harvesting medicine. You know, I've got tobacco leaves that I've picked in the last couple of days that are ready to be, you know, put into little bundles as gifts or into tobacco ties. My heart is full thinking about doing that. And I also have to take care of me so I can be in that relationship with those medicines in a good way. As Robin said, the next children's book, You Hold Me Up, Speaking Our Truth, A Journey of Reconciliation, the truth of this place we call Canada, and the policies and legislations that have caused immense harm to our people, and also to the relationship between us and non-Indigenous people. Excuse me, Lucy and Lola, Tilly and the Crazy Eights, When We Are Kind, the most recent children's book, I Hope, illustrated by a non-Indigenous illustrator. And I asked specifically for that because I wanted to be able to role model, especially to children and young people, that we can come together, we can collaborate, we can find a way to create something beautiful together. And then Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults. I first read Braiding Sweetgrass in 2015. And when I finished reading just the prologue, I had to set it down and let all that I had read find its rightful place in me. It took me about a year to read Braiding Sweetgrass because I would read something and I'd have to put it down and really ponder and reflect. And as I said, let things find their rightful place. And so in 2019, I had a phone call from a friend. Her name is Tracy Sorrell. She's a Cherokee author, children's picture book author. And she said, so, you know, there's going to be an adaptation of Braiding Sweetgrass for young adults. And I giggled and I said, well, good luck to whoever's going to do that. And she said, well, actually, I put your name forward. And so I didn't hear anything again for a couple of years. And then when the process started for the adaptation, I had 6 months from the signing of the contract until the final edit was due. And the first thing I did was I went away for a week because our house is busy and I needed to be able to focus. I needed to be able to call in all of the supports from my ancestors, from those on the other side, from the water. I went to the ocean and I went to a place where the birds, where everything is so vibrant because there's very little influence from society. And I started the process. And this, a friend took a picture of me as I was working. And I think this picture captures the joy of the project. The process was every morning I'd get up at 4:30 and I'd write until about lunchtime. And then I would go outside and work in the yard and I would listen to the audiobook of Braiding Sweetgrass to what I was going to be working on the next day. And then at night I would tinker. But this was the process, because only 1/3 of the original manuscript could be in Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults. And there were some new pieces to add. So you can see the orange stickies, the big white stickies are each of the sections. The orange stickies are each chapter. The green was the teaching of the plants. The pink was Indigenous wisdom, and the pastelli was the scientific knowledge. So I needed to make sure there was a braiding of those three. So that was kind of the process. And this is also kind of how I plant my garden, is I sit down initially and think, okay, where am I going to put everything? How am I going to make the most use of this space that I have in order to contribute? Like, how do I care for the most space I have so that I can be in a reciprocal relationship and receive the gifts from the land? As I said, at night I would tinker. So when I was working on Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults, it was the ninth book I'd worked on. Never before would my cat crawl up like this. Her name is Piper. And those of you who know cats, when you look at her, you can see she's smiling. And I think she could feel the love of working on this project in ways that perhaps not other books had drawn her to. So that was the process of the adaptation. And as many of you will know, the three strands in Braiding Sweetgrass are Indigenous wisdom, scientific knowledge, teachings of the plants. What we've enhanced in Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults is history and social and emotional learning. So I'm just going to give you a brief example of each of these elements. So the scientific knowledge, this beautiful chapter on asters and goldenrod. And you can see here one of the illustrations by Nicole Neidhart, a Diné illustrator. And she did an illustration for every chapter. And it's every illustration, there's so much detail to unpack. So you might notice that the asters and goldenrod in this illustration are in the shape of a heart. And she researched what would have been the bees native to where Robin lived when this story that's in Asters and Goldenrod in this chapter was shared. And this is the illustration of when Robin's mom just slightly removed the blanket from her, and she saw asters and goldenrod for the first time. This is an example of what pages look like. So you can see the braid up in the right with that question, why is the world so beautiful? Is a question I hope we're all exploring. Underneath that, a definition so that, you know, people don't have to go to the back of the book. Also, because there were a lot of words, I'm not a botanist. There were a lot of words I did not know the meaning to, so I had to include them as well. The gray rectangles are experiments, reflections, things to do to keep the learning process, whether we're learning individually through this book, in a classroom, or around a dinner table, or in a book club, reflection questions to deepen our learning. This teaching from the plants, if you ask permission, you have to listen to the answer. So, you know, when we go picking berries, sometimes we have to drive for quite a ways to get to where the berries are. We make our offering in my teachings, we offer tobacco. We don't pick the first ones we come to, we offer tobacco. We offer thanksgiving for the gift and ask permission. And we know, you know, when they're resistant, it's not quite time yet. So we pack everything up and we go back home. So if we ask permission of the plants, we need to listen to the answer. This is in the spring here, we had some work done in our backyard. I had to lay down a little bit of cement for the fence. And I didn't know if some plants were going to come back up, but you can see this one coming right up through the earth. And it reminds me of one of our words in Cree, sagigan, which means like when the plant emerges through the earth, sagigan. And it's also the root for kisagitin, which means I love you. I love that in our language, and those of you joining us, many of your languages will have very similar teachings like this, that when the plant emerges through the earth is also the root word for love. I think about Indigenous wisdom as another one of the strands in the Braid of Sweetgrass, and the honorable harvest. Never take the first one. Listen for the answer. Use everything that you take. Ask permission. Take only what you need, or as many will say, what you're going to give away. be grateful, minimize the harm, share what you've taken, and reciprocate the gift. Reciprocate the gift is, you know, do I offer something before, if that's part of my teachings? And if it's not, reciprocate the gift is, how do I care for the land? You know, how am I in that reciprocal relationship of care for this gift that we call Mother Earth? The Haudenosaunee Thanksgiving Address is part of Braiding Sweetgrass and Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults. And Robin, not wanting to overstep because she's Potawatomi, not Haudenosaunee, asked permission from Haudenosaunee Faith Keeper and Onondaga Nation member Orin Lyons for the gift of including the Thanksgiving Address. And this is the illustration that Nicole Neidhart has done. So I love this because this illustration itself can be used with children, I think, as young as two. To say, like, let's look at this, and what are you grateful for? Like, introducing that language early on, so that having a heart and a mind of gratitude, we cultivate at a young age. When we think about our teachings and gifts, you know, this teaching, the unique contributions that only we can make. When I received my traditional name, Mystique Washkigos, which means little drum, I was in treatment as part of my journey of recovery for alcoholism at a place called Round Lake. This was 32 years ago, this season actually, in the fall. And we had a UWP ceremony. And when the ceremony was done, I had been given this name, Little Drum. And when the ceremony was done later on, Uncle Malvin was teasing me a little bit. He said, you know, we didn't give you Big Drum. And, you know, if we were together, you'd see like I'm a whopping 5'1". He said, but we give you Little Drum because part of the gifts you come with are to remind people of their heartbeat. And when we think about for every single one of us, when we're in our mom's tummy and our ears begin to develop, the first sound that our ears hear is that double beat of her heart, which is like so many of our songs, that double beat, right? And that is one way we can be in a reciprocal relationship. That is a gift we can give to the land, is to sing. As we're having things grow, as we plant, as we harvest, as we're watching the beauty of what we are hoping to harvest and someday unfold. So to think about your gifts that you've been blessed with, and how do you contribute in a good way to be in reciprocal relationship? And it's our responsibility to use our gifts and our dreams for good. Those dreams can be dreams we have of our future, the dreams we might have of the future for the people we love, the dreams we have for the future for this land, for Mother Earth, to be healthy again, not to be encroached by fires, to be vibrant. And what is our responsibility in using our dreams and our gifts in a good way? So when I think about, you know, that was the Indigenous wisdom strand. And when we think about history, for me, it's about making the invisible visible. It's been a big part of my work here in this place we call Canada, is writing stories that tell the truths of our history. And so in Braiding Sweetgrass for Young Adults, we've pulled out a little more of the history, because here in Canada, this young generation, and I'm hoping in the place we know as the United States, that this young generation are the first ones in school to learn the truth of the history. And so this is the residential school near my grandfather's community. You can see the main building there, where classes were held, where the learners slept. You see the support buildings, you see the two churches in the back. You see to the right, the huge garden where the students worked. You see the fence, and then you see the families, who, even though they couldn't be with or touch or kiss goodnight or teach anything about the medicines or harvesting or care for the land, at least they could see their children. And having had my twins, I know I would be one of those families. You know, schools operated in your country from 1819 to 1969. Here in Canada, they operated from 1831 to 1996. So not so far in our history. And it's absolutely crucial that young people understand the truth of this history, because the expression of hate has become so free to happen that we have to have ways to educate hearts and minds and spirits about the truth. And so ensuring history is an element of that in this book. The piece also that we pulled out is social and emotional learning. Imagination is one of our most powerful tools. What we imagine, we can become. When we look at history, we see how in many ways imagination was not thriving, and our imagination is thriving today. The fact that we are gathering in this way, it was somebody's idea. Somebody's imagination brought this forward, and then the collective grew on it. So the gifts that we bring in our imagination are so important, and they help us to have hope. This belief that the future will be better than the present, and having the self-determination to make it so. So self-determination to me means who and how I think I can be in the world. Some people say this word is agency. I'm not fond of that word agency, because for me, it often means sort of like a Western organization being of service. But I think of self-determination. And I think about our history and all the ways policies and legislations remove the ability for us to be self-determined, and how really profoundly strong the self-determination is coming back. The fact that, you know, my sister and I are the first ones in three generations to grow our medicines again, that is self-determination. The fact that my children know how to harvest those medicines is self-determination. The fact that I'm on a learning journey of relearning my language is self-determination. The fact that we care, for this land in ways that uphold the dignity of those whose land were on the Lekwungen speaking peoples also supports the self-determination of the nation. So to think a great deal about, you know, how and what ways are you self-determining your life? Are you growing medicines? Are you learning about medicines? Are you reconnecting to who you are, where you came from, who your people are? What is the language? What is the land and the water and the stars that you are ancestrally connected to? And sometimes we are thousands of miles away from there, but we can close our eyes and we can go there. And when we do that, something in us recalibrates and it heals. So that's part of my invitation to you, is if you are not in your homelands, in your mind's eye, you can go there. So I think a lot about self-determination, because I think it is critical in how we move forward. It's how we move forward with our roots, with our hearts, how we help to foster good medicine and food. And it makes me always think about this quote: imagine how less lonely the world would be if we knew and believed we didn't have to figure everything out by ourselves. And I think of this for sure, you know, figuring it out with our human relatives. But I really think about it also with our non-human relatives. The times that I most need to figure something out and feel a sense of belonging is outside on the land, by the water, listening to the birds, listening to the squirrels, watching the hummingbird, and be reminded of the importance of paying attention to the moments of joy. All of these are ways that then I don't feel so lonely. And when I don't feel so lonely, then I act in another way. When I'm feeling lonely and desperate, I don't feel like being in a reciprocal relationship, because I only just want or need. And so we need to be caring for ourselves by being on the land or by the water as much as possible. And sometimes when I'm traveling for work, I'm in massive metropolises. When I look up, all I see are skyscrapers. But there's always some place where there's, even sometimes it's just a square of grass between the steps. And I take off my shoes and I stand there for a moment. Or I find the flowers, you know, to smell a rose or to smell anything. And those times, it just helps to heal, to be present. And, you know, how when I think about all of this, I think that love is medicine. Our love for the land and all that she shares with us. When we love like that, then the medicine comes back to us in the reciprocal relationship. And so being on the land and by the water and under the stars nourishes our spirits, which is different than self-care. Self-care is like I go for a walk in my neighborhood. I feel better after. It's good for me. But when I need to nourish my spirit, and when I know that the darkness might be coming, right? When we know life things are happening with people we love and the darkness might be coming, I need to nourish my spirit. I go to the forest. I go to my backyard. I go to the ocean to help nourish who I am. And so one of the things that I often get reminded by elders and wise people is that when you talk about history, that you must always leave people feeling better than when they might have come. Because when we talk about our history, for some of us, it releases that cortisol that I talked about earlier, the stress or potential trauma. And so I want to leave you with a little flood of oxytocin today. And so, as I've said, oxytocin is released when we're outside, but also for many of us, it's released when we're with children, when we see children. And so sit back and enjoy this brief, about 2-minute montage of beautiful children. And then we'll close as the video comes to close.
In a place that needs change, make a difference. In a time full of noise, just listen. 'Cause life is but a breeze, better live it. In a place that needs to change, make a difference. In a world. Somebody wrong, make it right. Oh, don't hide in the dark. You were born to shine. In a world full of hate, be a light. La 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 You can't win, slow it down.
Yeah, you only get one go round.
'Cause the finish line is 6 feet in the ground. In a race you can't win, just slow it down. In a world full of hate, be alive. See black and white in a world full of hate. Be a light.
So thank you for the gift of being with you today and for sharing. Thank you. And I look forward to, I understand we have some questions, some chat time. So looking forward to having a visit.
Yeah, thank you, Monique. Beautiful presentations. Oh man, so much to think about. And I love the ending montage there, seeing all those young ones and elders there enjoying life together. And Shanoa is going to be helping us out with questions. I'm not sure, Chris, if we can just bring the whole audience into view, just so that Monique can see who's in the crowd. To the gallery view real quick. And you know, just thank you so much for being here today, Monique. And looking, the Braiding Sweetgrass was a deep book, and so I want to take a look at your version of it and share it out with some of our youth as well. And just thank you for putting that together and reinterpreting it and making it understandable for our younger generations.
Well, thank you. It was the greatest honor I've had and also the most intimidating project I've ever worked on. Yeah, because I think in some ways Braiding Sweetgrass is a sacred text. And so it was, yeah. Yeah.
Let's see. I'm not sure if you're there.
Yes. Kwasanu Shamaj, Monique. Thank you so much. Just been having such a nourishing experience here. And my colleague and I have been monitoring the Q&As. So they may not be appearing in the actual box, but I, for those of you who have submitted, because I've been putting them in a separate document so we don't lose them. Mm. So one of the first questions we had received was the purpose of our gathering is to nourish our hearts and spirits as Indigenous peoples by reimagining our connection with our plant relatives and ancestral roots. In what ways do you reimagine your connection with our plant relatives and ancestral roots?
I think that's, I mean, I know I had seen that question and I thought I'm not going to delve into it in my thinking too much at the time because I wanted to just see what would unfold. But what keeps coming for me is in the reimagining is to let the plant relatives and the earth tell me what is needed at the time. And part of that is that I need to go out in a good way. It's funny, I was saying to a friend, like I was having, my mom isn't very well right now. And so I was having a really rough day about 2 weeks ago. And I had sweetgrass that needed to be harvested. And I was like, I can't do that in this place that I'm in. And my friend said, actually, maybe this is the best time to harvest. Like, let the medicine help to heal you. And don't think that what you're feeling is going to go into the medicine. Let the medicine come to you. And so in that reimagining of a different way of being with the medicine, you know, that's what I smudged with before our time today. And so I think about the reimagining is not only a reimagining, but a remembering that, you know, if we think about ourselves, every one of us, that there is a cellular memory, you know, science calls it epigenetics. We've called it blood memory or cellular memory in our communities for forever, that we remember our history. People say we remember the traumas, but I think we also remember how we care for the land, how we harvest, how we plant. All of that is in us. We just need the reimagining, the quiet time to remember. So that would be my sharing this morning with that question. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Monique. That's such a beautiful way of understanding that. Thank you. And then the next question that we had received was, as a young person who is not Native American, but still identifies with many cultural values, how do you advise on collaborating with Indigenous community orgs and leaders in racial environmental justice work with respect to cultural differences?
That again is a massive question. And I think that it depends on the organizations there are and the people in the organizations, because I think sometimes organizations reflect the healing of the people who are part of the organization. So there will be different organizations that are really welcoming to non-Indigenous people to be part of and to contribute, to use their gifts to contribute. And there will be some organizations that aren't there yet. And maybe some of those organizations see that the value of their people doing the work is what is needed right now. I don't feel like I'm like, and I don't even want to use the word expert, but I don't feel like I have the background fully to answer that question. I think perhaps maybe Michael or Charlotte, you know, how she opened for us, really laid down those beautiful teachings about collaboration. So perhaps there's others on the visit today who could answer that question in a more meaningful way.
Yes. Definitely, I don't know if... feel free to chime in, folks. Charlotte. But no, I think that's fair. I think it's a fair answer, but...
Yeah, we're just starting out the day, so I'm so sure some of these themes and questions that are coming up now answered. It has a magical way of doing that, but
it does for sure, Michael. Yeah,
there was a question in the chat about getting your books, and I know that Ashley put a response in there too, but if there's some other way, I think it says bookshop.org.
Yeah, and I have a website. If you just Google my name, you'll come up to the website, and then the books are there also. I always encourage also, if you have a local bookstore, please shop at your local bookstore. They can order all of these books. The more we can keep things closer to home, I think that's always a great way to support.
Definitely. I know Michelle Week had sent a question in the Q&A. She said, I am a farmer. How do I incorporate and stay in alignment with the Honorable Harvest Wisdom while also affording to pay my apartment rent and support my partner, navigating medical bills, and generally afford some time off occasionally?
Mm-hmm. That is sort of some of the push and pull, isn't it? I'm not sure what you're farming. And so, you know, depending what you're farming, but I think some of those teachings, right, around, you know, how do you prepare for your season? What are and we don't always have to put anything down that's tangible. We can say to the land as we're getting ready to cultivate it, to lay in the seeds, you know, thank you for the gifts that you'll be blessing us with. Thank you for the gift of allowing me to care for you. Thank you for the gift of bringing green and bright and light to this land. Thank you for the gift of helping me to take care of my family. Thank you for the gift of helping me to take care of myself and those who I love. Thank you for helping me to understand how to be in relationship with you. So that it's one way to know that we are then in relationship with whatever is going to come up. And some of you might notice that sometimes when you buy something from a farmer, so for example, a couple of weeks ago, I was actually visiting Robin in where she lives in Fabius, New York, and we stopped to get peaches from this farmer. And she said, we've got to stop here because he has the best corn. I was like, okay, yeah, corn on the cob, yum. And then he had peaches he had just brought out that had been picked off and they were still warm from the tree. So we got in the car and you could smell the peaches. Oh my gosh, the smell was amazing. But from the time that we arrived, he came out from the barn and we visited with him for 45 minutes. He was this jovial spirit who was 87, who had been farming for years. And he told us all these stories, all kinds. He just told us so much in this visit, laughter. I was moved to tears a few times just by his endearment of his love for the land and farming and what he grew. And then we got in the car and, as I said, the smell. And so I reached in the back because I couldn't wait. I felt like a three-year-old waiting for something really yummy. And I took a bite of that peach and things went, you know, it just spurted. But the taste was absolutely magnificent because I could feel the love he had for the land and for farming in that peach. And so he says, you know, he never worries about being taken. It was one thing he said, I don't worry about being taken care of because my farm always takes care of me. So I'm not sure, you know I'm talking about philosophical ways of being in the world and spiritual ways that perhaps might not always pay for the bills. Sometimes we might have to take another way of being to raise income in order to take care of our family and ourselves and keep farming. So I just thought that story of that gentleman might help you have some answers about how to balance your love for the farming and for taking care of yourself.
Thank you, Monique. That's really, really powerful message. Another question kind of going off of the farming was from Sylvia. She asked, please recommend how we can get started growing our own medicine. Where do we get the seeds?
I'm not sure where. Do you know where Sylvia lives by any chance?
I believe here into the Northwest, in Tacoma. Okay.
So that would be a question I would turn to those of you living there. Do you know where? Yeah, Michael, maybe you, I see you smiling and nodding. Maybe you could answer this better than me as a guest.
Oh, I was just thinking about, you know, real, the serious farmers get into like what zone that you live in, the 8A or 8B, all those types of things. But, you know, really, you know, I'll just answer personally that, you know, a lot of it, of gathering those medicines are, you know, you need to learn the environment around you and begin to just study our own plants and medicines and, you know, being out in the woods and how to you know, transfer, you know, those seeds and how we've traditionally done it. And there are a number of, you know, like, Charlotte could come on here and share. And I know there's some folks in the, on the, present on our gathering here today that do a lot of work in, the food sovereignty and, you know, harvesting and growing our own medicines. I see Morgan Brown's on here as well that, you know, I think getting involved with the local communities that are, that have those types of food sovereignty programs, and beginning to learn with those groups is a good way to start.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And I just made another post in the webinar as well. There's an organization called Alliance of Native Seed Keepers, which has some really great, resources as well, to get heirloom seeds.
And I was gifted, you know, I was gifted the first little round pod of tobacco, a tobacco seed. And then, you know, when you open that seed up, there's, I think, anywhere from 50 to 100 little seeds in there. They look like poppy seeds. That's how small they are. So that was a gift. And then the school district here, one of our schools had a medicine garden. One of the educators, her name is Sarah Rood, built a medicine garden with the young people. And then our district decided to expand the school and they were literally digging up the garden. And so we went to rescue these plants. And so that's how I and my sister got our sweetgrass. So I think that sometimes the medicines come when we're ready, that the medicines that maybe, you know, I was seeking them, I was ready, you know, at 50 years of age, it took a while. And I know that young people are coming now in much more vibrant ways at younger ages to learn about the seeds and about planting and about harvesting. So I think they come to us when we're ready.
Yeah, I'll just mention in the chat is exploding with all these different resources. So thanks everyone for the group. The Hive Mind is at work.
That's awesome. Oh, definitely. Yeah.
Yes. And one more, well, we got four more questions that I'm seeing. Another one from Britt Reinierson. I hear how you've woven and braided sweet, or I hear how you've wove braided together the themes of braiding sweetgrass into a young adult adaptation. What other meaning does the image of the braid have for you after completing this project?
In my teaching, sweetgrass is a woman's medicine. And those three strands come together to remind us of a balance of mind, body, and spirit. And in each of those three strands, there's seven actual pieces of sweetgrass representing the seven teachings. Some people will say representing the seven generations who went forward, the seven generations behind that, you know, I'm on a bridge and on one side I'm, you know, the descendant of my ancestors. And on this side, I am the ancestor to my descendants. And so that's part of what that braid symbolizes for me. And today it means more a responsibility. Working on this project means a responsibility for me to remember my ways of learning and being and living in these lands that I have the privilege to live on. And it also means that I have a responsibility to share as much as I can. And to not pretend when I don't know, like when with that question that you asked, like, I don't have the answer. I wish I did, but I don't. But somebody else will. And if I take up the space, then they don't get to shine. And so we have to share the shining with all of us. Allow all of our gifts to contribute to the hive mind or the honey, right? Contribute to the honey.
That's beautiful. I love that. The honey and then share the shine. Oh gosh, that's beautiful. Our next question was from Morgan Brown, who said, I read your book with my daughter and my high school students in our Indigenous science class. We all take turns reading pages, and your book is an inspiration to many of them. We are also in the process of healing with the land at the high school by cultivating an ethnobotany garden of kinship, ecosystem of plants. How do you imagine your book within a place-based high school curriculum or lesson plans?
Oh, the one place that I always most imagine is a different learner every day, just flipping through kind of with the eyes closed until they come to a braid of sweetgrass, and that be part of the discussion or the teaching of the day. So, for example, I just flipped to, if you ask permission, you have to listen to the answer. So, you know, I've got to go out and do some more harvesting of my tobacco leaves. So it's like, okay, which ones are ready to be harvested and which ones are not yet ready? And it's that discussion. And I think, you know, a discussion like that is not just about the plants. If you're working with young people, asking about permission has so many areas of conversation with it. So I think that's one way it can be used. I think having some of the illustrations up in your place of space, ensuring that the Indigenous language of the land that you're working on is part of your garden. And if you have young people who are from different nations, if there's a way to put those languages also of the plants and medicines you're growing, those would be two places that I think could be like projects to work on to help raise awareness of the garden you're doing, and also of weaving in Braiding Sweetgrass for young adults.
Wonderful, thank you. And then is it Ellie Arena says, Monique, thank you for being here with us. When did you know you were ready to write your book? As a young person, I feel like obviously I have my lifetime of learning that it never ends. So when do I know that I'm ready to put what I have into writing?
Well, I hope it doesn't take you 20 years to listen to the messages or, you know, a health crisis to start writing now. There might be many evolutions of books that you have to write, and not to wait to start writing now. And when you feel like what you've got is ready, you know, give it to somebody who you trust to give you feedback, and give it to somebody who you don't have an intimate relationship with to give you feedback. And then when you make some changes that are in alignment with you, like don't make changes that you don't feel are true to you. And then go to the library or go to the bookstore and see who publishes books that is similar to what you've written. And then go to their website and see what their submission requirements are. And then send your project in. That would be my encouragement. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you, Monique. One of the last questions that I've seen was from one of our fellow staff members, Shelley Vendiola, who says, Tiguasid, Monique, such a loving presentation. Her question being, could you speak a little bit more to the books you mentioned before, which were You Hold Me Up and the I Hope book?
Sure. Almost all of my children's books end with a question. So for example, I'll just reach and grab those. So this is like My Heart Fills with Happiness. And then the last page is What Fills Your Heart with Happiness. And I did that because I used to notice when my wife and I would read with our kids, if there was a question in a book, they got engaged in another way. And so I wanted that to be the last question, so that when a child was then transitioning to sleep, the last things that were going through their head was happiness. And the other thing I always noticed was that when we would ask a question from a book, that they would turn and ask it to us. So then that question then goes to the adult or the cousin or whoever's reading to them. so that then there's this intergenerational healing that unfolds. With I hope, you know, this is the Cree and English edition, with the illustrator being Gabrielle Grimard. And when we read a book to children, we always say who the illustrator is, because we might be sitting there with a future illustrator. And if we don't uphold the dignity of the person who drew the pictures, then we might not be upholding one of the gifts that they've been blessed with. So this is, you know, the last page, and it says, I have lots of hopes for you and for me, but I wonder, what are your hopes? And so it opens the door for children to begin to talk about hope, that that becomes part of their vocabulary on a daily basis. The book You Hold Me Up is about all the ways that we hold each other up. You hold me up when you're kind to me, when you respect me, when you play with me, when you laugh with me, right? Like, I hope, Michael, you know, that you actually do some teasing and some laughter today, even though your sister who's asked this question is present, because laughter is a form of medicine, right? It's one of the ways we hold each other up, is to giggle and laugh together. You know, you hold me up when you respect me, you hold me up when you listen to me. So these ways of being together to help children to understand, how do we be together in a good way, in a way that is safe for people, a way that fosters belonging, so that then when we become older and we can purchase, we don't need belongings because we have a sense of belonging. So those are the children's books. You can see on my website, I've read a few of them. You can have a look on the website and where they're available. Yeah, thank you for that question.
Monique. Thank you so much for answering all these questions and being with us today.
I also wanted to say could you remind me the person's name who asked about school, using Braiding Sweetgrass for young adults in school?
Morgan.
Yes.
Was it Norma?
Morgan.
Thank you. The Braiding Sweetgrass for young adults also has a teacher's guide available on Learner Publishing website. And also I've recorded the audiobook. So depending on your learner's different styles of learning, those are also available. So yeah, thank you. It's been such a beautiful way to start my Saturday. My heart is overflowing. So thank you very much to all of the organizers who for months have been planning. All your good thoughts, your good feelings are here today. And I'm very grateful for that. Thank you, Michael, for the beautiful way you've been holding space. Yeah, it's been a privilege to be with you this morning.
Well, Monique, we don't have enough time, man. We've given us so much to think about. We need to have you here all day long, but I know we live our busy lives and we have some other speakers coming, but what a dynamic story. I mean, there's facets of your story that we didn't get to hear, and your life in recovery, and your, you know, coming from Kamloops and knowing that the, you know, the residential schools background and that history. I mean, this work is courageous, you know. Just thank you for doing it, because you know, oftentimes, you know, we come from those backgrounds where we have a lot of challenges and things we overcome, and you've really for me personally, and I'm sure for others, you know, have inspired you know, from writing to recovery to, you know, doing what you're doing. And just want to stand you up for a little bit and just thank you for that tremendous work. And as you can see from the chat, there's a lot of, you know, thoughts and ideas coming back for, you know, back and forth. So we thank you for that inspiration as well. And usually we like to have the whole gallery be shown, but I guess we can't do that on the webinar, but usually I get everybody to do the sign language applause for you, because we can't all chime in or clap. So I'll do it on behalf of our participants, and just thanking you. We hope that our participants get time to spend with you in other spaces, because it really was a great presentation, and we wish you well. Thank you so much for being here.